Welcome to another episode of Around the 412. I am Tyler, and with me, as always, are Smitty and Herb. What up? I forgot we're part of the Pod Hub Network, but...
I forgot we're part of the Pod Hub Network.
Well, yeah. I mean,
we are part of the Pod Hub Network.
It's funny because last week you commented on how smooth it was.
Yeah.
And then I scuffed this one.
That's crazy that it was our last episode because it's been a week and change.
Lot happened immediately after we stopped recording.
Yeah. So, like, I mean, obviously we're going to talk about it, but it's literally, like, while we're on the way home. And it wasn't even, like, progressively. Like, we're sitting in the car and I tell Beefy that...
We're in Robinson.
Yeah.
So it's not like we're, like, far
you were 10,
from
15
your
minutes away from me.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I tell Beefy that I just saw that Darren Drager tweeted that Arizona and Pittsburgh working on a Kessel deal. And even before I get home, it's done.
And the next thing I see is a text from Smitty going, Beefy, crash the car.
I was going to say, we saw it in Robinson, and before we got like past Aliquippa, the trade was done.
Yeah.
Insane. Yeah.
But anyway, okay, so first things first that I want to mention, we are going to be doing the Josh Bell ball giveaway on air right here. And I'm saying this right now, if you are not a listener and you just entered that, there's no way you're going to know that you won the ball. Because
so we're doing a Trash Cats thing.
We're not, yeah. Shout out to the Trash Cats for doing this because, I mean, it's smart. Like the
wonder
idea,
if they listen.
The idea of the giveaways is to give back to the people that listen, right? I mean, we don't care if it's just some random person that doesn't actually care about what we're doing. So if you're not watching right now or you don't listen to the podcast when it's posted, you're going to have no clue, and we'll do the giveaway next episode.
Smitty's again. Making
it. Speaking of which, did the second person claim the chair from Trash Cats?
I didn't see. Because
so
I wasn't able to
watch
it.
Might be around three?
Yeah, might be around three. So that, and
Smitty's making a very hard line for these Russian bots to come kill him.
No, where did I say the ones were from that I was reading today?
Ukraine,
yeah.
Just in the middle of Pripyat.
Yeah, like two straight entrants were from Ukraine.
So. Yeah,
and then
Aliquippa. I'm not sending
huge
my ball
Josh
there.
Bell fans in Ukraine.
I'm not paying to send the ball there.
Right. So there's that, and also the Rock Around the 412, which we tweeted out about. I mentioned it on the last episode, but now the link's out there. Big shout out to Mike in Illinois, our boy.
Right off the bat.
Maniac.
Yeah. With a big donation right off the bat to get it kicked off. But to give everybody a little bit of background info, obviously you can go read the story. It's our pinned tweet on Twitter. But, you know, this year we decided to change it up from last year. So last year we did a great thing. You know, we donated some toys and the gift card to the Aliquippa Specialty Pediatric Center, which is great. But this year we're going to seek out families that are in need at Christmas time and purchase the kids Christmas presents. You know, not every family can give their kids a Christmas, and we don't like that here. We grew up, we were able to have gifts to open on Christmas, and we feel like every kid should be able to do that. So anybody listening, if there's a family that you would like to nominate, please let us know. If you're listening, honestly, like, you could be a person of a need that's listening. So, you know, whatever. We do need the contact information from the parents. Obviously, we want them to be okay with this. You know, we don't
want
to.
You don't want to just walk up to someone's doorstep and be like, I have something.
Hey, we got stuff to give your kids.
We know that you need help. That's not the way to do it. So let us.
What kind of help?
Get in touch with us. And, Year 2 of Rock Around the 412 is officially launched, so that's a good thing. Now, let's jump into what we're really here for, because I have no idea how long this is going to go, where this is going to go. Around the 412 is about to go places it's never been in the hockey world. So, today, tonight, whatever time you're listening to this, we got Jeff from the Pens blog on. Jeff, what's going on?
Audible. What's up, guys?
Yeah, this is where we include that little clapping sound that you would typically hear. There you go.
Oh, God. Ear rape.
So, anyway, before we get into the Kessel trade, the Tanev signing, all these things that happened in hockey, I want to know a little bit about the Pens blog. So, tell us a little bit about the start of that and the growth that you've seen it to today.
So, I actually wasn't around for the original Pens blog creation. That was Derek and Adam. Pull one out for those guys now that they're... you know,
here's
kind of retired from the blogging game. I kind of got my start during the lockout in 2013. I started Penguin Sauce, actually. And then Rich and I kind of sparked up a conversation as kind of the years went on, and eventually after he hung up his boots, I took over the Pens blog. So since then, we've brought on, obviously you guys, all know Pat, Yep. Jesse died in the process and was reincarnated with the Athletic. we got Peep doing his thing and being a goddamn maniac.
Yeah.
We don't need to invoke his name.
He does CrossFit for anybody that doesn't know.
When you mention him, he appears.
Yeah, you have to say his name three times into a mirror, though.
Are you allowed to tell us his real name?
We know his real name.
We do?
We do.
I'm blanking so hard.
I know his real name. Okay. He knows his real name if I say it.
Anyway.
Yeah, he posts his real name on Instagram. It's not hard to figure out.
Okay.
Oh. I missed that. Whoops. Anyway.
If you can find it out by the end of this episode, somebody has to give five subs.
Yeah. So you mentioned the first year you started doing it was during the lockout. Why during the lockout?
Because I was fucking unemployed.
Oh, okay. There you go.
And it was a lockout. Probably bored out of your mind.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was literally blogging from my parents' basement. Like, I was that guy.
Oh, where we
so what people
are.
Think we are.
But yeah, I mean, so it kind of all started. There were four of us. Josh, being one of them. He writes for us at the Pens Blog now. He does all of our game days during the week. Check his shit out. He is he's intelligent as all hell. So he and I we went to college together. Two of our other friends that we went to college with. We just decided one day in the middle of like November that we figured we would just do this thing. We had a connection that had his own network that we went to college with as well. He set us all up and just kind of cut us loose, and that's kind of what got me going.
That's how the best things start. Just okay, let's do it.
Yeah, you're looking at a good example of it right here.
Yeah,
Twitter. Twitter created this. Anyway, so you came on in 2013. Here we are in 2019. What type of growth have you seen this thing take while you've been there?
Yeah, so it's been kind of a weird ride for us. Kind of since Derek and Adam kind of hung it up, because a lot of the old school readers, kind of left with them. Those guys had a huge following, and kudos to them for getting into the blogging game, kind of at the ground floor. So we've kind of been kind of generating our own sort of following, I guess, you could say. So we kind of have a different group, and it's almost as if like we kind of had to start fresh, but still under the Pens Blog, name. So it's been kind of interesting, but, I certainly like the direction that we're going now. Obviously you guys have seen, it's a little bit less of the dick and fart jokes and more actual hockey talk now.
So like our podcast when we get into the winter.
What's that?
So like our podcast when we get into the winter.
Yeah.
I do have to ask while we're here on the topic of Pens Blog anyway, what is your favorite comment that just like absolutely tries to roast you?
I once got called a crack addict loser.
Okay.
Fair assessment.
Full disclosure, I have never done crack.
I would hope.
I got called a crack addict loser back when Crosby had the mumps because I didn't report on it before like the beat writers did. It's like, I'm
okay.
A blogger. Like,
yeah.
What do you want from me?
You mean I'm supposed to do it before the people that have inside sources with the team?
I don't know why Sid just didn't text you about it.
Yeah. Did just go to his house, have dinner with him. Oh, man, that's an interesting one. I did not know that one.
Yeah, and obviously, like the spreadsheet ones are always pretty
God.
Good.
Yeah.
Now that I'm getting more of those, but yeah, the crack addict loser one is always the one that sticks out in my mind.
Yeah, that one's gonna be there forever.
Okay, so what are the goals, if any, that you have for Penn's Blog?
I just want to keep growing the following that we're kind of generating now that it's kind of like our own little community. It's kind of refreshing, to see how we've kind of almost grown organically, and are kind of getting back to being a source for, you know, actual analysis anymore. Because I mean, you guys see it too. It's kind of the direction that the internet game is going anymore, as far as like sports blogging goes. It's less of the jokes, less of the Photoshops, less of you know, all of that stuff, and more of the actual you know, meat and potatoes of the game. So I like the direction that we're going. Obviously, we still mix in a lot of humor, just by virtue of having Peep exist. But I like the direction that we're going, and I'm proud of all of the work that everyone's kind of put out, you know, since I've taken over.
Cool. Okay, so, man, I mean, we're going to be talking about this for...
Speaking of meat and potatoes, we're about to get into it.
Forever. Like, so that's why I'm going to be talking about it on here for the rest of this podcast, basically, for as long as this thing goes. You're going to be talking about it. Jeff, I mean, we'll probably have him back on, but...
Oh, absolutely.
For right now, I honestly just want to say, Phil Kessel trade, and just see where you can take it, and we'll go off of you. Because the three of us are going to be talking about it for the rest of time.
And I feel like at least two of us are going to go right with you.
Yeah.
So my initial reaction was, like, with anything involving Phil Kessel, like, there's obviously there's that expiration date, and I get it. I think we all kind of knew when they traded for Kessel that he wasn't going to see his entire deal out.
Right.
And I think the one thing that sort of soured me on the initial return, you know, being what it is, was the fact that the Jason Zucker return was perfect. Like that was what you could ask for. Zucker's a guy that's gonna wow you at.
Uh oh, his black hole service.
Did I cut out?
Yeah, you cut out. You went all black hole on us.
All right,
right around Zucker.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. So that was for me. Like that was the perfect return. You know, Zucker's one of those guys. He's a dynamo at 5-on-5. He's gonna be you know, great in his own zone. And he's got the wheels to just burn by guys. And obviously, you know, being able to offload Jack Johnson in the process was, you know, a no-brainer. But you know, you get down to the nuts and bolts of it, and Phil only wanted to be one of two places. He either wanted to be here, or he wanted to be in Arizona. So you kind of have to kind of take what you can get at that point. I'm not impressed with Galchenyuk. He's certainly good offensively. Certainly not as good as Phil offensively. He has all the same flaws as Phil. I think there's kind of a misnomer thinking that you know, of getting Malkin is just going to be the guy that elevates someone like he did with James Neal. And you saw that really only lasted a season before James Neal kind of cut his way out of town. So
kind of soured on everyone.
Yeah. So it's one of those things. I don't. It was the best return that you were going to get for Phil, given that, you know, he either was going to stay or he was going to go. I think that that P.O. Joseph, he's supposed to be something special, but again, he's probably 3 years away, maybe two. So you know, you kind of have this prospect that you really don't know what you have in him. And a lot of the same problems at 5-on-5 that you had with Phil, just without the same scoring. So, for me, I wasn't pleased with the trade. There's no secret around that, but, I think Galchenyuk can be good, and can be good on this team. It's just a matter of, you know, kind of getting that out of him, but we'll see.
So two things that I have as far as questions for you. The Zucker deal, would bringing Rask back in that deal have dampened your mood about, you know, being able to unload Jack Johnson is one. And as far as Galchenyuk, do you like it or dislike it, the fact that he's only under contract for next season? Is that a plus or minus for you?
So I'll start with Galchenyuk. I kind of think it's a minus, because, you know, you look at it, if he plays really well and he scores you 60 or 70 points, then you're going to have to pay him more than the 4.9 that he's making now. You know, if he's not very good, maybe you can offload him at the trade deadline and get something for him. And maybe you still do that even if he is performing well. But the problem is, you know, if he doesn't work out here and you let him walk in free agency next year, then that's another year wasted. So that's sort of, I don't know. I think the 1 year is a negative. I think I would go that route. And as far as Rask goes, at least with him, you know, if he is as bad as he's shown the last 2 years, you can bury him on the fourth line and not really lose any sleep over it. Whereas with Jack Johnson, I mean, you are stuck in your own end of the ice night in and night out, shift in and shift out. And I mean, you can't with a team that is so reliant on their defensemen getting the puck up to their forwards quickly. You know, Johnson is more of a negative than I think Rask would have ever been theoretically.
Yeah, I agree. Just about the talk about the Kessel trade itself. I know that, you know, we're talking about hockey here, but, and not to say Phil Kessel was Antonio Brown, not even close, but it's, I look at it in a situation where he wanted out and there was only, you had limited options. You had to take the best return available. Like, no matter what, the Steelers were not keeping Antonio Brown. They got a third and fifth for him.
Did he actually want out? Because I saw, like, after that happened, that there were conflicting quotes.
I'm saying from if the Penguins...
There are conflicting quotes, but I saw that no matter what the quotes were, whether, like, he had requested a trade during the season.
Okay.
That's fact.
Yeah, so what I understand is there was a little bit more truth to Rutherford's words than there were Kessel's words.
Okay.
So, but where I'm going with that, I'm not trying to say Phil Kessel was the cancer that Antonio Brown was, but the Penguins were trading Phil Kessel. The Steelers were trading Antonio Brown. There was really only one option to go for both of those teams with that one player. You were taking the best return possible from that one team. So in the small picture, I think the Penguins did okay on that trade, but it's, you know, the reasons that they had to make that trade that suck.
Yeah, I would absolutely agree with that.
And one of those things is Jack Johnson, which, you know, obviously, like, we talk about, you know, do the Penguins actually believe that this guy's a serviceable player? I mean, the fact that they were trying to include him in that Minnesota deal, I don't know.
So I think it really seems the more and more that you kind of read between the lines with some of the beat writers and all the wacky shit that Rutherford's been saying this whole offseason, you kind of get the sense that he's okay. You know, he's ready to move on from Johnson. It's just a matter of finding, you know, someone that'll take him. You look at some of his quotes after he dealt Mata, which I could not be any more against. But you look at some of his quotes after trading Mata, and it kind of, he came back. He kept circling back to, you know, he was looking to move one of Johnson or Mata.
Yeah.
Couldn't move Johnson, so he just decided to move Mata. And it's like, well, you really don't have to pull the trigger on the trade. You know, the guys that you still need to sign, they're restricted free agents. They're not going anywhere. So you can wait all summer if you have to get them under contract, and it's really not a big deal. Where you know, with kind of trying to pull the trigger on you know, moving one of those two defensemen, you can wait a little bit and kind of finesse what you need to finesse. But it seems like he just didn't want to wait on any of that and just got trigger happy.
As Jim Rutherford does.
Yeah. And make no mistake about it. I mean, Dominic Cahoon is a good player. He's going to be a really good player for this team. I just, you know, if you had the choice between trading Mata and Johnson, it's a no-brainer which one you move.
Absolutely. And there was so much hate that came out for Mata right after he got traded. I mean, I get it, he was slow, but the rookie season he had, all he's been through, he was still serviceable. Jack Johnson never, I don't think, maybe once in his career has been serviceable.
No, and you know, that 1 year was the year that he scored like 30 points on the power play.
Yeah.
You know, he's never been good at 5-on-5. But at least with Mata, like, yeah, he had his problems, you know, pivoting when guys kind of took him wide at the blue line. But by and large, I mean, he was a very good defender when it came to shutting everything down in front of the net, you know, kind of cleaning up the slot. He was a very good defender. He could break the puck out. Now, you know, his foot speed kind of gets a little bit overplayed. But I always kind of likened him to Paul Martin, where Paul Martin was never impress anyone with his foot speed, but he was just a guy that read the game so well that he was always in the right place at the right time. And yeah, Paul Martin could get beat wide, but he was always a guy that was getting back to dump ins and chip ins and you know, being the first one back there to break the puck out and move it. And Mata was very similar in that regard. The only thing that held Mata back was, you know, turning.
Yeah, pretty much. I get people saying he was overpaid, but I don't know.
Cap keeps going up.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, you look at other top four defensemen around the league, especially in that kind of 3-4 hole, they're making anywhere between $4 to $5.5 million. And that's the going rate. And you know, they bought I think they bought a year of his unrestricted free agency with that deal that they signed him to. So it was one of those things you could pay him a little bit more, even if it was, you know, $500,000, to buy that extra year of unrestricted free agency where he really is kind of at his top level.
Yeah. Imagine if they didn't sign Jack Johnson and trade for Eric Goodbranson, we'd still probably have probably both of them, Kessel and Mata.
Yeah.
Damn.
I think even in that kind of that hypothetical, I think Phil probably gets traded next year anyway.
Agreed.
But I think I know Jesse has mentioned it numerous times, and I'm gonna echo what he says too, that they kind of traded Phil a year earlier than they probably should have, but yeah. You know, those are the cards you're dealt.
I guess from the Penguins' perspective, Jim Rutherford's perspective, it was, we don't view Johnson and Mata differently enough. We don't think there's enough of a gap there to get nothing for Johnson as opposed to an NHL player in Cahoon for Mata.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, whether that's the right decision or not, I don't know. Personally, I'd rather not have Johnson than have Cahoon.
Yeah.
But
I agree with that, because yeah. you look at someone like Cahoon, you know, you kind of already have a couple players like that in the system already, and I'm sure we'll get into Brandon Tanev as well. Oh, yeah. But he's another one. Like he's a good player. He's a fine player, but he's not $3.5 million good, and he's not 6 years good. You know, so you have. You have these internal options already that, you know, had you moved on from Johnson and not brought a younger NHL forward back, you still would have been in okay shape. I mean, the Penguins forward group really wasn't an issue last year. And even this offseason, you know, building the team that they were kind of building, it still wasn't and isn't an issue. The biggest hurdle is on the blue line.
Yeah,
specifically the bottom pairing, but there are, you know what? May as well ask it now since we're on the topic. What do you expect from Schultz this year after being meh last year? Credit due to injury, but
I would expect him to hopefully be better than he was the last 2 years.
Yeah,
I mean even 2 years ago, he really was sort of underwhelming. You know, last year you can chalk up a lot of it to. You can kind of chalk up a lot of it to the injury. You can chalk up some of it to playing with Jack Johnson. But even you look at some of his minutes away from Johnson, they were just as bad with him as they were without him. So it's tough. You know, it's a contract year for him too. So you know, there's sort of that implication that he'll step up and really try to earn, you know, above that kind of $6 million threshold. And I really believe that they're going to go back to 2D on the power play too. So that'll definitely benefit Schultz and inflate his you know, primary stats a lot more, to kind of get him that money. And I think that's somewhere that he really fits with this team is quarterbacking that power play and having Letang over there off to his left.
That's crazy. It's already another contract year for Schultz.
Yeah.
Just seems like we just won their second cup in a row.
Right.
Yesterday. But yeah,
so if he improves, I was gonna say, if he improves and looks like, I won't say what he was in 2017, because whenever he took over for Chris Letang, he was amazing.
Yeah, that was insane.
But if he improves, would you be interested in signing him if it was a good amount? Like the Penguins could sign him for a good amount of money for the Penguins, or would you just let him walk?
Yeah, that's sort of the caveat. You know, they're always kind of up against the ceiling. So it always comes back to if the term and the money are both right, then yeah, absolutely, I bring him back. But if he wants north of $6 million as what, a 30-year-old, he's 29 right now. He'll be 30 for his next contract. Yeah. I don't know that I pay a 30-year-old more than $6 million. Because, you know, he's a good player, but he's not someone that's going to break a game open for you like Chris Letang does.
Yeah, you know what? All I was going to say was, you know, he had the benefit of being the number one guy with Letang out his last contract year, where he doesn't have that. Well, hopefully not.
Hopefully.
Fingers crossed.
Yeah, but he was also it's interesting too, because even in 2017 when he was putting up all those numbers and playing mm-hmm. that well,
yeah.
he was still playing sheltered minutes.
Yeah.
You know, you look back, especially in that cup run, it was mostly Dumoulin and Hainsey eating up all of the really difficult minutes.
Yeah.
Hainsey was a nut.
Hainsey had that Tsukian goal. That was insane.
Yeah, he just sent James Neal's jock to the moon.
Oh, another man.
Never forget that year.
And Schultz is a right-handed defenseman, so he can just say, "I want more money," than left-handed defenseman.
Yeah, and that's sort of the other tripping point there too, is because, you know, you're not going to find many right-handed defensemen available, whether it be in a trade or in free agency. They just don't make it there anymore.
Right. Yeah.
Speaking of one defenseman, I actually don't remember if he's a right-hand shot or not. Thoughts on Jake Gardner?
You're ruining my list here.
Because I've seen your conspiracy theory. I want thoughts first, and then you can say your conspiracy theory.
Well, so I should preface the conspiracy theory by saying that I was extremely drunk when that thought popped into my head.
Okay.
I was going to ask, how legitimate do you think that is? But that, I guess that answered my question.
I still stand by it. I mean, it's not – so you think about it.
I have not heard.
When
anything.
Was the last time before Rutherford pulled the trigger on bringing in Derek Brassard? When was the last time there was a three-way deal? There was Duchesne and Turris, and how long ago before that? I mean, this guy, for all of his faults, he's a brainiac when it comes to when it comes to kind of manipulating the system like that. So I don't think it's out of the possibility. I mean, you look at the guys that they're going to have to really move out, specifically for Pettersson and Bluger and Aston Reese. You know, they have $3.5 million tied up in Russ, and he's a commodity that teams are going to want. And then you have the two albatrosses on the blue line that you know you can. Realistically move, especially Gabranson, given how he played down the stretch, and being a right-hand shot. So that's anywhere between $6.75 million and, you know, $7.5 million that you could potentially move out to kind of give to Jake Gardner. Now, the big thing with Gardner has been no one knows how healthy his back is.
Yeah.
But the kid can play. There's no denying that he's another one that's kind of gets gets chastised a lot because when he's on the ice for a goal against, typically they're pretty big implosions. But by and large, he's a pretty good defender. He's definitely great in the offensive zone, and you know he's a guy that can skate and break and move the puck, and those are guys that the Penguins need, and he definitely solidifies that second pairing on the left side.
As someone who watched Leaf games pretty regularly last season, it seems like every time Jake Gardner has a misstep, it just kind of has to be a goal.
Right. Yeah, it's one of those stupid bad luck things that that happens to guys that are on the ice all the time, that have the puck on their stick all the time. You know, not unlike again Chris Letang, where you know he gets shit on in this town because when he makes a mistake, it is a big mistake, but he doesn't make many of them.
Right.
I feel like Beefy's about to say something.
Yeah, a couple years ago I had to call it Herb. Because Herb attacked Letang religiously
every week. Yes,
because I
didn't think he would be healthy.
Well, no. You brought up how he always gave up the puck. And so I decided to look up like the top 20 defensemen in turnovers. And it's all like
all
the
elite defensemen.
All
I
of
know,
the
yeah.
top 20 defensemen in the league because they handle the puck so much.
See, you're boiling that down to the simplest problem, though. That's the thing I harped on the most. But it was just the fact that he wasn't healthy and it was visible. And it just seemed like he might not get it back. Also, Bellinger just crushed that ball. To me, in that moment, that season, it was just like, is this guy going to be able to be healthy and get back to normal?
The crazy thing is, too, like, I mean, you could tell that first year back after the neck injury, like, he was definitely laboring, and he was a little bit, tentative going back into the corners, and really taking contact. But you look at a lot of his underlying numbers, and they weren't drastically different than they were the year before, which was, you know, one of his best seasons, if not his best season, outside of this year. I mean, this year he was unbelievable. But a lot of his underlying numbers weren't all that different than you know his previous years over the course of his career, and even you know even Doughty, Burns, and I forget who the other Norris finalist was that year, but I remember looking
Hedman?
At it might have been. Yeah, it was Hedman. Yeah, correct. Yeah, and I remember looking at Carlson's numbers alongside all of those guys, and you know Letang was on par or better than those guys in a lot of the underlying stuff. It was just that you know you could tell that just watching him on the ice, he didn't look right, but this year he looked every bit as that same guy from 2016.
Okay. What were you looking at there?
Going back to Justin Schultz a little bit, I was curious because we mentioned that there's not a ton of right-handed defensemen, so I decided to look up the right-handed defensemen that'll be free agents next season.
Petrangelo.
Tyson Barrie.
And the top 10 that are currently paid in order of salary are Alex Petrangelo, Justin Schultz, Tyson Barrie, Mike Green, Jared Spurgeon, Zach Bogosian, Sammy Vatanen, Justin Falk, and Cody Ceci.
Give me Jared Spurgeon.
Yes, legitimately yes.
Yeah, I would not hate Jared Spurgeon. And you know, I obviously I would love Tyson Barrie, but I think I just saw today he's looking for something like $8.5 million in his next deal.
So what you're saying is the Leafs are not going to re-sign him?
No, God no.
They're just going to give up a fourth line, and that's going to be the Tyson Barrie money. We decide to play with three lines.
19 roster spots.
Josh Bell's about to bat.
Oh, nice.
Turns off. So we had a good segue, and then Herb decided to break it up. So
that's what I do.
So Brandon Tanev, I think you know one of the first signings, like when it actually July 1st came at noon. Immediately, you see the two teams linked, and I mean, I liked it, like not the signing. The fact that Brandon Tanev was going to be a Penguin, and then the contract details came out.
Yeah.
$3.5 million for 6 years, and I'm like, what is this? Why? Like, who was Rutherford bidding against? Who else is giving him close to those years, close to that money?
So
Apparently Columbus was going to give him five.
Oh,
well, yeah,
again?
I was going to say, I was okay with Brandon Tanev.
Yeah.
And if the deal was, say, 2 to 3 years max, I could have been okay with $3.5 million.
That's what I thought it was. I was okay with that.
Like I still think it's a little. I still think it's an overpay. I still think it's overpaying at 3.5. But if it's only for 2 or 3 years, I can live with it. $6 million is like ludicrous.
Yeah.
Why listen, would you do that?
Listen, you senile old man. You give him the cap. You give him the cap hit, or you give him the term. You do not give him both.
Yarmo is over in Columbus, just rubbing his hands together, going, "If I get fired, he does too."
Like I don't care if. Columbus wanted to sign him to 5, and that he's your guy that you want. Let them sign him to 5.
And watch how bad
Don't
it is.
Don't sign him to 6.
Yep.
Well, yeah, and that's just it. You know, Columbus doesn't have anyone. You know,
yeah.
They lost everyone that they had.
Steve Nyquist. So that was their big free agent.
Really? Yeah.
they kind of have to go hard at some of these guys, and even then, like, they really didn't bring anyone in. You know, Ryan DeZingle's still out there, and he told them that he wants nothing to do with them too. So it's like, what are you guys doing?
Oh, I love it.
But I tweeted it out yesterday, and it's an awesome read for anyone that really likes diving into like the heavy math stuff as far as this sport goes. But Dom Lachizen. From The Athletic had a really good piece yesterday where he spent all offseason kind of breaking down all the signings and kind of putting together a bunch of visits where he kind of looks at their expected value and what they're going to bring over the course of their deal. Along with that was a piece from Adam Gretz where he looked at some of the signings from the last couple of years that were 5 years or longer, and 69% of them ended in a trade or buyout. Extremely nice, except when you realize that the Penguins signed fucking 2 of those.
Oh, I hate my life.
So I guess I should have asked first. If it's okay that I swear on your show.
Oh, yeah, it's explicit.
But, fuck yeah.
But I am just powering through.
In the words of Jared Oliva, oh, fuck yeah. That's a guy we're friends with in the Pirate system.
So he broke down, you know, kind of what each free agent signing this year brings as far as, like, his game score stat, which basically just boils down, like, each game's, you know, pluses and minuses, not the bad plus and minus, but the actual like pluses and minuses that a player does.
Yeah.
And kind of boils it down into like just a single score for that game. So basically he put this piece together, looking at, it was all 37 deals that were signed, for $1.5 million or more. And just what their expected value over the course of the duration of the contract would be. And you can count on one hand the contracts that were exceptionally good. I'm going to read off some of the good or decent contracts and see if there are some names that may ring a bell.
Oh, I'm going to love this.
So Richard Ponick signed 4 years for $2.5 million each.
Oh,
he's got a 68% chance at being a positive impact player for the entire duration of his contract.
I actually have 2 players. I want to see if either one of these are before you read them. Johansson and Donskoy.
Johansson was 41.7% because his expected value on the contract was $7.8 million versus the 9 that he got.
Mm, okay.
But Donskoy is on there, just north of 50%. His expected value was $100,000 less than, or $100,000 more. Sorry,
than his
contract value, but he's only expected to be a positive impact for 2 out of the 4 years. Mm. But the other player was Brett Connolly.
Ooh, yeah, Florida.
Who signed for? What was that, 3.25
mm-hmm.
for 4 years. His expected positive impact is 3 out of that 4 years at 54.5%. Brandon Tanev, 0 of his 6 years.
I don't know. I'm feeling like year four is going to be real
only
good.
Only year four.
And a positive value of probability of 28%. He is the 11th worst on this list.
Who's nice. The worst?
Valtteri Filppula.
You went back to Detroit, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the Tyler Myers deal, which like everyone knew was a bad deal, is the second worst.
Where was that? Vancouver?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
What is it with them and just big guys and horrible contracts?
Jim Benning just refuses to commit to anything.
Tyler Myers is going to be a penguin. Give
it 3 years. No!
Give it 3 years.
Also, yes, Jim Benning does just like to throw money around.
He 1 year he's committed to speed and skill, and then the next it's big bruising guys.
He's like, we didn't make the playoffs. Oh,
but St. Louis won, and they're a big team, right?
Yeah, exactly. I'm surprised Jim Rutherford didn't start trying to get Reeves
bigger.
Back. Yeah.
I think that was one that Sullivan kind of. You can kind of tell when Sullivan was putting him on the ice. It's like, what the fuck am I supposed to do with this guy?
He's a Lego piece that doesn't fit.
That might be the title of this episode. Yes. Or actually, I do want to know what Jeff thinks. Not the contract, but just Brandon Tanev himself. And I also thought maybe the episode should just be called "Brandon Tanev is Brandon Tanev." Because that's one of the things he sent me when we were messaging.
Yeah, so I think Tanev's interesting. I mean, he's a decent enough player. He's definitely fast. He's tenacious. He gets that intangible that he's tough to play against, whatever the hell that means.
Good luck. Isn't
that like half of the NHL according to all coaches?
Yeah, it's so bizarre too, because you look Gretz again. Shout out to Adam. He mentioned it in his piece with Pensburg today that you look at what every player in the NHL says at the end of the year when the Players Association puts out that big poll, and they always talk about how Crosby, McDavid, Tate, Bergeron, those are the guys that are the hardest to play against, and it's like, well, these aren't these big heavy hitting. Fourth line guys, they're your best players on the planet. So it's like, it's almost as if like this idea of being hard to play against is just this stupid old school mentality. But I mean, that being said, Tanev is a guy that will definitely be a nuisance to play against. I mean, he is going to bear down on you. He's going to bury you, with his forechecking. He's going to hit you every time he's in the zone, which was something that the Penguins really, really missed with, letting Chris Kunitz go. Not that Kunitz was really effective at 37, 38, 39, whatever he is now. But it's one of those things, if you're fast on the forecheck and you get in there and you bury the defenseman, you're going to force turnovers, and that's what Tanev's going to do. It's not unlike what the Islanders did to the Penguins in that series. I mean, they got in on the slower defenseman on the puck moving defenseman and made them play the puck to the bad guys. But they were burying Mata, they were burying Schultz, they were burying Pettersson, shift in and shift out. So that's sort of the what you're going to get out of Tanev. I worry a little bit about his defensive ability, because he played almost exclusively with Adam Lowry in Winnipeg, who is far and away probably the best shutdown center in the league. He's very Jordan Staal like in his approach to the game. But he's a monster to try to match up against. So I almost wonder how much of Tanev was a product of Lowry.
Yep.
But again, he's going to be playing with either Bukestad here or Bluger, and neither of those guys are slouch centers. So he's at least going to have a center that can carry the line. But it'll be interesting to see what he can do. When he's cut loose with this system. But again, 6 years is too much, and $3.5 million is too much.
I answered my question without even having to ask it. I was going to ask, how do you think you'd do without Adam Lowry? But
yeah,
seems
so,
like you answered.
I saw the tweet that he was significantly worse without Adam Lowry and without Kopp, for that matter, but definitely Adam Lowry.
Yeah, it's sort of tough to really get anything out of his numbers, especially last year away from Lowry, because he only spent 100 minutes, I think it was, away from Lowry.
Oh, okay.
So you're talking for him about a 10 game sample size, give or take. And we saw even with I hate to bring it back to Jack Johnson, but we saw even Jack Johnson could keep his head above water for, 5, 6, 7 games.
Yeah.
So
2.5 weeks.
Yeah. So that could have been playing into it, but I mean he definitely shoots the puck. He's a slightly above average shooter. So that's at least something that's beneficial to that fourth line. But again, it comes back to the Penguins having already had this exact player in the organization that they're gonna, probably pay a third of the price for in Zach Aston-Reese. And I know there are certainly some health concerns about Aston-Reese. He might not be as fast as Tanev, but he's certainly a guy that's going to bury you in behind the net, and he's got an element of skill to his game where, you look at sort of the side-by-side comparison between the two, and Aston-Reese played harder minutes and produced better. So it almost kind of makes you wonder why did you need Tanev when you had Aston-Reese and you have Adam Johnson who can play in that same role.
Right. Okay. Last question that I have for you, and then we have to go and talk about other sports because that's what we do, I guess.
I have one when you're done.
Okay. All right. So you ask yours first.
I guess I do have one too.
I want to finish on mine.
Okay. So what's your question?
Pause.
Wait,
what's your question?
Mine should probably be the last
riveting
one.
Riveting content, fine.
Okay,
go.
Fine. Does yours have to do with the Penguins still?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Well, okay, either way, I wanted to ask do you think they're going to try to trade Rust? Is that what you're going to ask?
No, not it's similar, but no.
Do you think they'll try to trade Rust because of Tanev?
Yeah, I would. I don't see any point in having and having two guys making $3.5 million playing on either wing on the fourth line. They brought Cahoon in specifically to play in the top nine. Dominic Simone is an elite player. I refuse to be told otherwise by anyone that wants to focus on his 6% shooting percentage.
You're in common company here, okay? You're safe here.
You're safe. No one can hurt you.
No one's going to hurt you here.
Well, good. Then I guess you guys aren't on Reddit.
No. Oh, I do not want to go on that Penn's Reddit page.
I get fucking buried for Simone.
Believe me, Smitty and I got called assholes by one of our friends earlier this season for defending with Simone.
Who?
Sarge.
Oh.
We tried to explain. So you remember whenever, was that in the playoffs?
Yeah, Gensel put that pass at his feet.
Yeah, Gensel put the pass at Simone's feet, and he couldn't, get it on the 2-on-1.
Yeah, because it wasn't a
Do
great
you remember
pass.
That play, Jeff?
Yeah, I got fucking roasted for that.
Yeah, so so Smitty and I are trying to say that's not Simone's fault that Gensel gave him a bad pass. There's no way he could have scored that. Like, even Crosby, who's one of the best in that situation, probably has, he'll make score, one or two out of 10 times receiving that pass.
Simone could have scored. It would have just been really fucking impressive if he did.
Well, the funny thing is, he got a piece of it with the toe of his stick.
Yeah.
He got it off of his skate. Into his stick, he didn't get enough on it.
I wonder if that's why people were mad.
But I mean, a clean pass.
Yeah, he should have just completely. He should have completely fanned on it, made it go past, let it go past him, step over it,
intentionally
or something.
Throw it.
Yeah, that way it would really just look like a really bad pass, which
yeah,
it was.
It was.
Snapped his ankle, got deported to Saturn.
To Saturn.
Yeah. Because we were trying to explain that wasn't Simone's fault. We were assholes.
All right. So
okay. So I am going to completely derail this segment. I have to ask because I'm cynical.
Well, then never mind. I did ask mine first.
Okay, go.
Who's getting traded next?
Okay, that's still cynical, but okay.
I would have to say it's gotta be either Russ or Johnson.
You don't buy into the Bjugstad trade hype?
I will literally die if they trade Bjugstad. Yeah.
Right,
that just
you?
Doesn't make sense to me. You spend multiple years trying to get a third line center that fits. You find one,
do.
And then let's trade him. Like,
well, and especially because like I think Jared McCann can fill that role at some point. I just think he's better on the wing. I don't know if he's better on Crosby's wing or not. I don't think he is compared to Simone. But at least you know with Simone what you're getting, no matter what line you play him on, and he's going to be the same player no matter where you play him. Where McCann, I think he's better suited to play on Crosby's line more than he is on a third line role. But I think there's a thought that you know maybe in 2 years McCann can be that long term fix on the. On the third line center role, and I'm fine with that, you know, in 2 years. But, you know, you have a 26-year-old in Bjugstad making just a hair over $4 million that, you know, is going to get you 40 to 50, maybe 60 points if you're lucky, and is just a matchup nightmare in that three hole. And I just don't understand why his name keeps popping up. For the same reason that you guys said. I mean, they spent, you know, since Bonino left, trying to find, you know, a third line center. They finally have it, and now trading him away just doesn't make sense.
Yeah, and like you said that you like McCann or Simone better on Crosby's line, but I really like that Simone Hornquist Bjugstad line. It was probably one of the best lines when they put it together last season.
Oh yeah, they were lethal together down the stretch. It's one of those things, you know. Do you want Crosby to score like twice as many goals as hit 5-on-5 as he was, or you know, 1.5 times more? So nothing's going to really change as far as Crosby and Gensel go. I personally would like to see Hornquist play on one of the top two lines. I think he still has a lot more to give. And again, putting a $5.8 million guy on the right wing on the third line is an expensive choice to make. Or 5.3 rather. But yeah, I as far as the Penguins top nine goes, I don't think they can any combination as long as you have you know Crosby and Gensel together. They seem set on Malkin and Galchenyuk. And then Bjugstad with whoever he plays with, you know, you're not gonna go wrong with any combination up front. But it's a really tough pill to swallow to have you know $7 million on either side of Teddy Bluger.
Yeah, most depth charts I've seen have had Malkin with Hornquist and Galchenyuk.
Yeah, and I think that would be a good fit. I think I honestly think Simone might be a good fit on that right wing too. I know Cahoon's decent defensively, but any of those three guys can pick up the slack as far as the defensive zone goes. Because you know Galchenyuk's not going to be good in his own end, and Malkin kind of you know has his days, but you know you'd almost rather stick them with someone that can. You know, that's comfortable defensively and let Malkin and Galchenyuk just do their thing offensively and see what they can do.
Yeah.
Okay, time to get sad. Okay, so I have to ask, how close are we to midnight with this team's window, in your opinion?
It depends on – it really depends on the next move. You know, Rutherford really has to get this right. And again, it all really comes back to whether or not he's going to move on from the two anchors that he has there on the bottom pairing. You know, if you have another year of Johnson and Gudbranson on this team – it's another year closer to being shut. I still think you probably have about 2, probably 3 years left, provided that the right moves are made. I think Crosby's still going to produce until he's 37. I don't think that's really going to change. Malkin, I'm a little bit more skeptical about. I think he can still he'll still be producing at a pretty high clip even at 35. He doesn't really play a high impact game anymore. So I think he'll be okay. You're going to have Gensel locked up for another 5 years. Letang's still going to be Letang. I mean, these guys all train like freak shows anymore too. So their bodies are I think more prone to lasting a little bit longer. And, you know, at the end of the day, this team will go as far as, you know, those four and Murray will take them. You have those two centerpieces with Murray and Gensel going forward that I think they're still in pretty good shape here, at least for another 3 years. Outside of 3 years, it's tough to tell, but I mean we're probably about 9:00 p.m. right now.
Okay, fair enough.
You mentioned Murray. Now another question: would you try to sign him before this season starts? Or extend him, I guess.
Yeah, I think that's something that Rutherford's really trying to do too. A lot of the reports coming out of the front office is that they're trying to get him locked down before training camp. But if it's me, I bring a barge in with as much money as he wants that he can shovel off and just go from there, because this kid is good.
And when he finally empties the money, we throw Jack Johnson on it and it goes to India.
tell him he can sail off with it.
I read something online where some dumbass said they should let him walk or think about letting him walk
because he probably loves Flurry.
That's where all the hate for Murray comes from.
You can like both.
Exactly.
Not in Pittsburgh. That's not how we operate.
I defended the ever loving hell out of Flurry even against all better judgment when he was here. And I mean the last 2.5-3 years that he was in Pittsburgh, he was phenomenal.
Yeah.
And even that first year in Vegas, I mean, it's hard to argue with the results, but Murray's the better goaltender. He is now, and he's going to be for the next, you know, for the rest of Fleury's career.
Yeah. And not to mention he's 10 years younger.
Right. But Fleury smiled a lot. He played jokes, and he was this fun guy to be around, but so was Pascal Dupuis, and he hit his expiration date too.
Sad night.
Although he was more so forced out of the game.
Yeah.
Even before the blood clots and everything though too. He was done.
What'd you say?
He was, and I stopped and said, "Yeah."
I thought you said he was yam. I was like, "Is that a saying?" Or
get hit.
It is now.
He might have been yam. Impossible to say.
Speaking of another dumbass thing I saw on Twitter, I saw someone like basically attacking Galchenyuk because they're mad about the Kessel trade.
Strange.
And I just don't think it's fair to dislike him already because you're mad at the trade.
People need
like,
to take
give
their,
him his chance.
People need to take their expectations from Phil Kessel and just not put them on Galchenyuk, even though they're absolutely going to.
It's like, yeah, no, he's not Phil, but that doesn't mean you have to dislike him right off the get-go. You haven't even seen him play.
I'm getting a Galch jersey, just straight up.
Oh, if you have a Neil jersey, just change the nameplate.
Yeah. Oh, I do
yeah,
not.
Like, people haven't seen him play. I think it's pretty unfair to him to do that.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, the poor kid's dead on arrival, just by virtue of not being Phil Kessel. But, it'll be interesting to see how he and Malkin do together. He certainly is a pure shooter, too, so... he's at least got that in his repertoire.
Yeah, I mean, people can like bitch and moan all they want, but if he comes out and like surprises us and scores 70 points, everybody's gonna shut up. So
won't be 82.
I'd be awesome if he scores 70.
Okay, well, I mean, I think that's about it. We still got two other sports to go and cover. So, anybody that doesn't, go follow Jeff on Twitter if you want to tell everybody your Twitter handle real quick.
It is G_OFF817 on Twitter.com.
There it is. You can also follow the Pens blog on there. And I'm sure he'll be back on maybe closer to the season. We'll see what else happens before then, because we still have a lot of time before that.
Month and a half?
There's a lot of 86 days from today. That can be done.
Yeah, the Sidney Crosby countdown started on Penguins Twitter yesterday. So
yeah.
Okay. All right, Jeff. Well, it's been a pleasure. Thanks for coming on, and we will talk to you next time.
All right, sounds good. Thanks, guys.
Later, man.
Take it easy.
See you.
What the hell is his Twitter header? What the hell is that?
That is.
Is that like SpaghettiOs in taco shells?
That is exactly what that is.
Yeah. What a freak.
Okay, so, there's not a lot to cover in the NFL. Thank God.
No.
You know? The rest of this show is probably going to be pretty quick.
Remember, we also have a show Saturday.
Yeah. Well, so in the NFL world, unfortunately, they lost a member of the football family, Jared Lorenzen, everybody that remembers the hefty lefty, the Pillsbury throw boy, passed away at the age of 38.
These are real names?
Nicknames, yes.
I'm surprised. Jared Lorenzen. Do you remember him?
Yeah, I just never heard him called.
He backed up Eli for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah. But anyway, passed away at 38. He had multiple medical conditions. I think he had like some heart trouble, some kidney trouble. So
I figured.
And also, Kendrick Norton.
Yeah, that was crazy.
Had to have his arm amputated. He's had multiple surgeries since. He still has to have two more. For anybody that's interested, his family did start a GoFundMe. I'll just throw that out there because the NFL is covering his medical expenses, but like he didn't play enough time in the NFL to get a pension or anything. So right now he is. Hopefully, you know, the Dolphins will do something for him.
Or the NFL.
I would say, do you think the Dolphins will just give him the rest of his contract?
I'm thinking, like, you know, give him a job doing something for the team.
Yeah.
Bring him on as, like, a scout or something, you know? Anyway, I feel like they'll find a way to take care of him. Nothing good happened. Teddy Bruschi had a stroke.
Yeah, I didn't even see that until I saw the ticker where it was like, he's doing fine after
which
stroke.
When the hell did that happen? I didn't see when it happened either. I saw that when he was recovering from it. Like, he was doing well.
What the hell?
So I don't know. And then Glover Quinn retired, and that's about it in the NFL world. So, like, nothing really good happening. No good news to report here on Around the 412 in terms of the NFL.
James Conner looks jacked at his new picture.
He does, dude. He's putting on weight. He says he's going to have.
Somebody clip that to where it just ends at,
I'm waiting for the. No, the clip is going to be hilarious when Josh Bell was safe. If somebody can get that for us.
Oh, it's going to happen.
But anyway. James Conner, yeah, he says he's going to have, like, the same role. I mean, you drafted Benny Snell. You saw what Jalen Samuels was last year. I feel like James Conner's going to show, not regression necessarily, but a little bit less. He's going to get a little bit less of a workload.
Hopefully not run him into the ground.
Which, I mean, I'm all for. Like, switching gears from a fantasy football perspective, that's not, you know, as an owner, you wouldn't want that. But from a real-life Steeler fans perspective, that's a good thing. Give him less carries. Switching to MLB, is there anything good that happened?
I don't know. Vlad?
MLB?
So, where I want to start, Tyler Skaggs passes away.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, I mean, obviously anybody passing away is sad. I guess I just didn't realize, like, how important this guy was to a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, just a really sad day for baseball. And, I mean, everybody, you saw the way his teammates responded, just seemed like he was a really good guy, was finally starting to put it all together this year. But he's actually being honored tonight. Both of his teammates that are in the All-Star game are wearing his number 45.
Everyone has 45 patches.
And they all have, the 45 patches. So that's really cool. But very unfortunate. There was the one newspaper already had to take out an article. They put an article out reporting that it was opioid overdose, which that hasn't come out.
No.
Like, yeah.
They said the family told the coroner to not say anything, but at least for the time being. I think they said the expected end date of the autopsy
it could take like 90 days, though.
October 2nd.
Yeah, it could take like 90 days. So, but listen, I don't even care.
Yeah,
like, you
exactly.
know, what does it matter? You know, it's kind of like the same thing as like the Jose Fernandez thing. I don't want to know.
Stubbs, you know you like it.
It is what it is.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he's not here. It's unfortunate. However it happened, I don't care about.
Yeah, exactly.
That's for him and his family to know.
Yeah.
His friends, whatever.
Just so random.
Where do I want to go next? Yeah, the thing that I care about the least, Pete Alonso won the home run derby.
Dude, that was fun.
How anticlimactic.
Yeah.
I can't, like, the only time that I was, like, really into the home run derby, minus when Josh Bell was hitting, was Peterson versus Vlad.
Vlad in general?
I guess so, but, like, the only round that I was, like, really invested in was those two going back and forth.
Even my little sister, who doesn't watch a lick of baseball, was watching it with me.
Yeah.
Because it was fun. That was insanity.
This has nothing to do with, you know, Josh Bell getting knocked out in the first round or anything, despite having the fourth highest home run total the first round. I said from the beginning I wasn't a fan of the Browns like that. The brackets facing each other, the head-to-head matches. It just doesn't make sense to me. You could have a round where a guy, this wouldn't happen, where a guy hits two and a guy hits one, and a round where a guy hits 30 and 29.
Yeah.
The guy with two is moving on.
Mm-hmm. I don't care about the time. That has officially been cemented in my mind after this past one. That could mean anything.
Yeah.
The bracket's not breaking it for me, but, like, come on. Come on.
No, and you know, thankfully we haven't had, like, a scenario like I just said.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Vlad had 91 home runs in the entire Derby.
Yeah.
Pete Alonso had,
overall,
40?
But I'm talking about just one round. Yeah.
He had, like, 38.
Yeah. Like, come on.
So, yeah. I mean, Pete Alonso was pretty impressive. He hits the ball very hard.
Yes, he does.
Like, not only does he have elevation, he hits it very hard.
I feel very bad for Matt Chapman.
Yeah, like I said before we started, his dad was trying to strike him out.
Yeah, and it was so last minute.
Pitching Ninja put up videos.
He's like, oh, I'm on an MLB stage? Yeah.
My time to shine. Sorry, son. Maybe you'll get back here next year.
I'm trying to get signed.
Maybe you'll get back here next year. I'm trying to get signed. Acuna was very impressive, who, of course, Bell had to go against. He had the second most in the first round.
Opposite way, though, too.
That was the thing.
I was surprised by Acuna. I completely forgot how good Jock Peterson was in the Derby.
It's like belt form.
Yeah, it really is.
Like I said, too, like the pitches looked like they're about to hit him on the hands, and he's taking them for home runs.
It was insane.
But Bell's performance overall, he hit 18. Like I said, the fourth highest total
better out
first
of
round.
Any Pirates player in the home run derby in recent memory.
Yeah, I don't think it was, you know, I wasn't unimpressed or anything. It didn't leave me.
It's respectable. You
know, yeah. I mean, I hated seeing him go out in the first round.
It's
course,
very good. It's just a shame that he got put up against somebody who just
and
went
if they,
insane.
If they reseeded when Yelich dropped out and Chapman came
he
in,
was number two.
By home run total, he would have faced Santana in the first round.
That would have been nice. That would have been really nice. Oh, well.
So then he would have just lost in the second round.
Ultimately, to me, it doesn't matter at all. I mean, obviously, to those guys, the winner gets $1 million, mm-hmm. blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
It means something to them, but me, right now, I don't care. Let's get back to the season. Pick up where you left off.
Hopefully he's, like, you know, pissed off about it. Come back into the second half on a tear.
For the sake of Twitter, I really hope Bell doesn't go into a slump.
Well, that's why I was like, low-key, it's good that he got knocked out in the first round. Now just stop swinging. Don't ruin your swing.
Or don't ruin your back.
Vlad Jr. looked gassed. So,
oh, he absolutely was.
Yeah. We'll see how he comes out of the break. But for Bell, I feel like he already hit his slump.
I think so.
He hit 206 or something in June. Not that, you know, bad averages is the NBL. Yeah. 208. So, I mean, I don't see there's no way he's going to have another month like that.
No, I don't think so.
And look at how he started off July.
Yeah.
Before. So, I mean, he's not Adam Frazier in July.
Yet.
Do you think, how much do you think Pete Alonso is giving his cousin that was pitching to him?
Oh. 100 grand.
None.
No.
No, he's already said he's donating half to charity, so.
Half?
Yeah.
I thought it was only 50,000. I thought it was 5%. Yeah,
did you
5%.
Maybe miss a zero?
No, I thought it was 5%.
Someone somewhere either added zeros or missed a zero. Who knows?
I don't know. I could be wrong. That would be a substantial amount, especially considering a million's like double his salary. So I'd be surprised.
The winner was
going to double their salary no matter what.
Yeah,
most of those
both
guys
of them are making $555,000 this year.
Yeah, most of the guys in the Derby would have doubled their salaries.
Mm-hmm.
Including Bell.
Bell and Vasquez representing in the All Star game.
Vasquez is a replacement.
Who'd
he replace?
Hater.
Oh, the racist.
Yeah. Cervelli's done catching. That came out.
Yeah.
Six concussions. I mean, it's unfortunate, but, like, it was definitely the right call.
Yeah.
You know, I know that he, not necessarily pushed back, but I know he wanted to continue catching at first. And, you know, it came out that he said, you know, I'm a catcher. Didn't seem like he was going to be open to a position change. But at this point, I mean, he thought about it. Six concussions. You got to do what the team wants anyway. I mean, ultimately, it's their call. They just don't put...
Well, I mean, for just like the sake of his health after he's done playing.
Yeah, and that's what he said.
Yeah.
But just from a team perspective, okay, you can say you're a catcher.
But we're not going to put you there, yeah.
We're not going to put you in the lineup card to catcher.
So he's going to be predominantly now a corner infielder, I assume?
Yeah, I mean, he's been taking grounders at third. We've seen him actually play first base before.
Yeah. I feel like he could be a good backup third baseman. Just, like, solid, but not on this team unless Gung turns into a black hole again.
Well, that's, yeah, his future's not on this team anyway. So, I mean, yeah. We're talking, you know, most likely, I would think, an AL team. Just because, you know, you hope the bat comes around. Yeah, comes back to where it was last year and, you know, 2015 as well. But, yeah, I mean, it's sad, but it was definitely necessary and obviously wish him the best, but his future's not with this team anyway. Yeah. So
also Bell's up with a runner
again
in scoring position.
So, yeah, let's do that real quick.
Also, I want to say this before I forget. Arenado made a hell of a pick and then committed an error.
Okay, so we're doing the Josh Bell ball giveaway, right? You have to be listening to this, whether it be watching us live, which you're probably not, or listening to the podcast when it's released. You have until, if we're doing again Saturday. Okay, well, you got until Saturday night to claim your prize. So I'm about to pull this. We are not going to reach out to you. So you have to listen to this episode to find out if you won.
Hey, North Shore 9, you're late.
And no one tweet them, if you know them.
You missed, like, the meat and potatoes. Get it.
Came just in time.
Yeah, for my legs.
That's what she said. Not to you, what he said.
That was really bad timing.
He said is what
I
she
know,
said.
I know. That was just really bad timing. Oh, that was incredible. Are you struggling over there? Oh, bot.
Is it a bot or us? Was it a bot or us? Someone in
Iran.
Ah.
Ah, a bot.
Not shipping to Iran. Sorry.
Yeah, only in the U.S., continental U.S., and maybe Canada.
Maybe Canada.
No Mexico, because we don't want you to take the pirates from us. Best socks from, I don't even know, I didn't buy these.
We're basically stalling.
This person's
this
in Greensburg.
Oh, Pitt Greensburg, nice.
What's her name?
John Patola.
Do they have a Twitter at?
It picked their entry from visiting around the 412 on YouTube, so you should all do that.
Yeah, you should probably hear this by Saturday, huh?
So, yeah.
How do you spell it?
The name?
Yeah.
J-O-H-N
mm-hmm.
P-A-T-U-L-A.
Patula. Why did I try and make that Spanish?
So, congrats, John. We do have your email here, but like I said,
we're going to make this fun.
You're going to have to listen to us. Talk. You're going to have to listen to us say your name. Hopefully I'm pronouncing your name right. In order to claim your prize. If you do not claim, by Saturday's episode, we're going to redraw this prize. So. All right. And last thing to finish up on. Everybody in Pittsburgh should really be enjoying what they're seeing right now from the Pirates.
People need to get off their high horses.
They're 2.5 games back now. The same amount of games back they were in 15 after those two crazy comeback walk-off wins. I get that they're a game under 500, but that doesn't really matter. The games back is the important thing. That's what matters for the division. 2.5 games back to the Cubs right now. The division's pretty much wide open, 1-5, which, I mean, I think a lot of us thought, you know, it would be the most competitive division. Not necessarily the best teams, just most competitive. All the teams are right there. Once again, it was Brian Reynolds playing hero
mm-hmm.
in their last game before break on Sunday afternoon with a 3-run shot.
We didn't break
Reynolds
him.
Reynolds.
Yeah. So you look at the season he's having, the season Kevin Newman's having, Josh Bell, obviously. Vasquez, unfortunately, his one loss happens on his birthday.
The
otherwise,
bullpen
we could have the Brewers.
I was at that game.
Yeah.
That's why they lost.
The ninth inning was nuts.
Oh, yeah.
It was so loud.
They come back from a 6-1 deficit.
Josh Bell.
Josh Bell, it's a 3-run homer, and then Gung ties it on the very first pitch that Dara throws to him.
Amir Garrett's pretty bad, man. Amir Garrett is pretty bad, man. I thought you said Amir Garrett.
No, it was Guerra.
Oh,
for the Guerra. Brewers.
Oh, well, he's bad, too.
He used to be a starter, but yeah, he's coming out of the bullpen now.
That game was nuts.
Anyway, yeah, what a ninth inning, and it's just unfortunate that, you know, you go to the 10th with Vasquez thinking, we're going to just get this to the bottom of the 10th, hopefully we can walk it off. And it's Vasquez that gives up the game-winning run.
Okay, I don't know. I was watching the, like, miles of the speed, the velocity of each pitch.
Mm-hmm.
Was he not throwing many fastballs?
I don't think so.
It looked like he was throwing a ton of off-speed
pitches. Yeah, and it's, you know, there's critics for everything, so... Somebody was saying, like, he just didn't care because it wasn't a safe situation, so he wasn't throwing hard. But anyway, yeah, he wasn't throwing.
Was that Clint Hurdle?
Many fast. It might have been a burner. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, well, he wasn't, because I looked at the velocity. It was like every, like, fifth pitch was a fastball.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't understand it.
Yeah.
I don't get it.
But
I just don't get it.
I don't, just this team coming in 11-5 in their last 16 right before the break, and a lot of those games, like we said, last time where we're talking about, you know, do they buy, do they sell? Well, they're playing right now in the stretch of games that are going to determine that. And even after the break, they're going to
Up until July 31st.
Yeah, ton of division games still. So, I mean, for me, I'm not going too heavy on the one side still. You know, I don't want to see them, you know, do another Chris Archer trade.
Manage your assets properly. That's it.
I don't want to see any of our guys get traded.
That's it. We're really selfish. That's it.
Yeah.
All I'm going to say... is the people that still don't want to support this team because of their owner, because he doesn't spend money. Yes, my feet are right in front of you.
No, I'm just looking at your feet because North Shore and I said Herb's sock game is lit.
Straight out of Walmart.
Wait.
The fact that people still harp on that is kind of funny to me, but you should be hoping they win this division because you get just the extra revenue from the games. You get extra revenue from the MLB. And that previously, the years they've made the playoffs, has been put back into the team. So you
and if it's not, then you have
reason.
Every right.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, if you do now, like, it's not like I discredit anything that most people say. Like I said, I don't care how anybody feels about this team.
Yeah.
As long as you can listen to what I have to say, mm-hmm. and I can listen to what you have to say. I'll always listen to what people say.
Yeah.
No.
We don't have to agree. But you just don't have to be an asshole.
But anyway, yeah. I mean, people can... be a fan however they want. It's weird to me how some people are a fan, yet it seems like actively rooting against, like you said, just because
absolutely.
Of the owner. But whatever, to each their own. It's a very likable team that is right now coming into the break on a very good run. And mm-hmm. it's got them 2.5 games back, which, like I said, the year that they won 98 games at the All-Star break, they were 2.5 back. So, and I think that a lot of, like what Josh Bell said, shout out to Noah Hiles when he was asking the question. A lot of the pieces that they need to be a playoff team are there right now.
Yeah.
You know, you need Archer to be Archer. What the one that they bought, you know, not the Archer that we've seen so far. We need to see him
be better.
Be better. Yeah.
And I mean, with Stallings, he's been better.
Easy to say, but.
With Stallings, he's been better. He's been good enough.
He's been better.
But he needs to be.
Well, that's the thing. His better has been. Middle to back end rotation,
exactly.
Where that's not what you needed from Chris Archer, especially with Tyone out now.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and who knows if we're getting him back.
Potentially Lyle's just bombing.
Yeah. I mean, I don't like what I've seen from him
recently.
I mean, obviously everybody was skeptical of that to begin with. I would have much preferred to seen him in the bullpen, but he was okay. It was very good as a starter out of the gate, but, you know, you wonder if it was just a mirage.
I like what I've seen from
Agrizol?
Yeah, thank
Dario
you.
Dario Agrizol?
Yeah. Yeah. I
want to
keep that.
You know what? He doesn't strike a ton of guys out, and that kind of worries you.
Yeah.
You know, how long can he just get guys to put the ball in play but get outs? It's worked for Trevor Williams. I mean, I'm not – but I know there's a lot of people skeptical of Trevor Williams' regression as well.
And Agrizol's been consistent. Spot starts against some of the best teams in the league. Just consistent.
Yeah. So, yeah. Like you said, some really good offenses. Well, Miami, but then Houston.
Yeah. What about this last week, Brewers?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's hard not to root for this team. And there is a pretty good chance that they do contend into September.
Yeah, that's what I just say. I mean, like, I'm not going to, you know, sit on here right now and say they're making the playoffs, but they're playing meaningful baseball after the All-Star break. So,
and the worst part about all of this is everyone in the NL Central has a better chance to win the division than any other second place team in any other division.
Yeah.
The entire division is within five games.
Yeah, the games back is
the Reds at 4.5 is smaller than any other second place team in any other division,
which is I think 6.5.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
every other division there is nothing.
I think it's an attribute to two things. How good the NL Central is, like, well, not good, but
how even,
how competitive.
Yeah. And two, where did I just lost my train of thought?
And two.
I don't know. Yeah.
Riveting.
Honestly,
I don't know where I was going with that.
Incredible.
I don't know where I was going with that.
So it turns out it's just one.
Turns out there's just one. How competitive the NL Central is.
I zoned out for like a solid minute and a half. Did you guys mention Adam Fraser as the player of the week?
No, we did not.
All right. Okay, good. Because I was like searching stuff on my phone and I like zoned out for like a minute.
I mean, I'm used to that.
What are you doing?
Trying to think of what I was going to say. I mean, I do feel like this is, I don't, like how weird the MLB is. Like, I think it's an anomaly how many games up the first place teams have that aren't the NL Central. Like, I don't typically think that you see first place teams up by this many games in every single division.
You don't.
So I think the next closest one is Cleveland to Minnesota.
I believe
and that's
not.
Crazy because Minnesota
six and a half.
Minnesota fell off.
Man, yeah.
I don't think they fell off. I think they're just coming back off of their high. Like,
yeah.
I don't think they're bad. They're I'm
Cleveland's
not going to say they're
a
bad team
too.
Now.
Yeah. I'm surprised the NL East isn't closer. But.
Who's in first in that one?
Oh, no.
The Braves.
Okay.
Oh, man. I thought I was pulling a
Smitty
for a second.
The Phillies have kind of. They're in the wild card spot right now.
I was going to say Philadelphia, but I don't know.
Meanwhile, the Dodgers are like. What, 40 games above 500 right now?
They're ridiculous.
I mean, they were talking on the broadcast right now. They're the best team in baseball.
Their run differential is like 200, probably.
They're the quietest, like, 60 and 30 ever.
It's going to suck when they lose in the World Series again.
Oh, absolutely. They're going to lose to the Yankees.
Astros.
Yankees stink.
Fair enough.
No, the Yankees don't stink. The Yankees are a very good team, but like I said, I'm just ready to fast forward to the part where they lose in the ALDS.
Yeah. My Red Sox.
Speaking of the Yankees, did you see Sergeant Ross talking about Yankees being an evil empire?
Oh, I was tagged in that because.
Oh, you were?
Yeah.
So what do you think about that? Are they the evil? Why are they the evil empire? Is it because they spend the most money? Like, still, I guess.
I mean, to me, that's just their nickname, and it's not going away. Like.
Yeah. I get that as their nickname.
Yeah.
I just think if you ask people the reason why, and it's because they spend the most, like. They spend the large amount of money, then there's like five evil empires in the MLB, and like two or three spend more than them.
But everyone wants to be in New York. New York just entices everyone there, and George Steinbrenner, blah 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 blah. Even though he's not there anymore, blah, blah,
and
blah,
they
blah.
Shouldn't. And they have like, they don't even need a good GM.
They don't
with what they have. Yeah. But Brian Cashman's a very good GM.
He is.
Cashman,
which is an incredible name.
Too bad he
for
wasn't
anybody
here.
Involved in anything that. Is baseball cash, man?
Could you imagine the jokes if he was the Pirates GM?
Where's the cash, man?
Where's the cash, Bob? Huh?
But yeah, I don't know. I've said my piece. All I know is the Pirates 2.5 games back to the All-Star break, and it's gonna be a fun second half, hopefully.
Fun final 3 months. Hopefully longer. Never know.
Yeah, I'd really like to have...
Once you get to the playoffs, anything can happen.
Pirates, Penguins, and Steelers all going on at the same time again.
Oh, man. Imagine the Pirates winning the division, winning in the first round, and all of a sudden the Pirates become the best team in Pittsburgh. How many people would be pissed? Every Penguins fan that just despises
baseball.
A lot
of people would jump back onto the bandwagon until...
They lose.
They didn't go out and get... A huge free agent after that.
It'd be the second they lose a series, and they'd be like, oh, the same old Pirates.
Yeah, they didn't bring in the guy to get over that hump.
Yeah, even though the hump was a better team.
But I don't know. Yeah, it's crazy how quickly things can change because, you know, an 11-5 stretch in the last 16 games has completely changed a lot.
I remember when
tone.
You two were saying sell.
Yeah, I mean,
well, yeah,
to me,
I still stand by when I said that.
But I mean, you guys were saying burn it down.
Yeah, I was. And I was confident in that.
If they would have gone the opposite, 5-11 in those 16 games, I'm still saying that.
I'll say circumstances can change.
Oh,
but
yeah.
Back then, I was full on the sell train.
And I'm still, like I said, not buying heavy like on like
no,
the
no,
Chris Archer trade. And I'm still trading Dickerson.
Oh, absolutely.
Because I keep Melky just because he makes more sense as the fourth outfielder than Dickerson. And then
you got to have Brian play.
Yeah. And hopefully Polanco comes back healthy, and I will take Polanco back over Dickerson.
I don't know. A lot of people are saying trade Polanco.
Listen, how in the era of the juiced ball and launch angle does Dickerson have no power?
What does he have, two
That's
home
a
runs?
Very good question.
Two home runs, and one of them is a home run and only
one stadium.
In the Astros Minute Maid Park to the Crawford box.
And every other season, he's had at least 24?
I don't think. No, he didn't hit 20 plus last year.
No, I meant like before he'd been a Pirate, every other season he's hit 24 home runs.
Really?
I believe so.
I think he's had three seasons where he's hit 24 more. So I don't think it was every season before.
Definitely, but yeah, it definitely was every season.
But yeah.
I hope Greg comes back and just starts smoking the ball.
Yeah, I mean, he honestly, to me, I didn't think looked that bad offensively.
I'm just sick of people saying
but
trade him.
He shouldn't have even been. He was very good last year, and then he got hurt.
Yeah.
Like, and you don't have anything to go based off of this
year. It's not even like these people's opinions are correct. Like, you can think what you want about a player. They're just like, oh, he was bad so far. They brought him back early.
And if he's that bad, why doesn't our team want him?
Exactly.
You'd be selling at him his lowest point. Like,
exactly. It's horrible asset management. I know people who have generally good ideas and good thoughts about just asset management and trades in general that are saying trade Polanco for a bag of baseballs.
That does make sense.
It doesn't.
And they want to extend Dickerson to see him pound the ball into the dirt for three more seasons.
Yeah. I'm over here saying sign Melky for the next 3 years.
I would like to take, if he would just sign 1 year contracts,
yeah.
I'd rather go 1 year at a time.
Oh, yeah,
with him.
No, I know.
Just, and he's all,
I was just
he's
being
like,
exaggerating.
Yeah, he's like the worst defensive outfielder in baseball.
Yeah.
So.
He,
that's why I said I just like him as a fourth outfielder. He'd come off the bench and hit. Honestly, like, it's going to sound stupid because it has nothing to do with baseball. I just like seeing him in like the clubhouse, how he interacts with everybody. He's just a funny guy to watch play.
Whoops.
So, I mean, I know that has nothing to do with baseball, but also a reason to, like I said, it's a likable group. It's a fun group to watch.
So, like I said a couple months ago, excuse me, having Melky start every day is a bad idea.
Yep.
He cannot do it.
Yeah, he's too thick.
And he can't read balls. Pause. Mm. Having him off the bench is like no one else in the league. It's almost a guaranteed hit.
I mean, look at the Pirates as a whole, pinch hitting.
Yeah.
I think that's largely attributed to him.
Absolutely. And Colin Moran. Colin Moran's been great this year, pinch hitting.
Yeah.
And with runners in scoring position. That dude is money.
Yeah. And he's getting a lot of opportunities
yeah.
with where he's hitting in the lineup, too.
Yeah. I get Colin Moran slow, but man, a guy batting 280, 290. I still have not seen the triple.
Yeah.
I just saw a tweet that said, Colin Moran triple, find shelter.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, man.
Okay, well, do you have anything else?
Mm.
9:30. It's getting late.
I
got to go to sleep soon.
Nice. I do, too.
Well, all right. Reminder, Rocking Around the 412, year two, it's officially launched. You can look at our pinned tweet on Twitter.
Also, keep an eye on the Twitter for another
tweet on Twitter. That's like a hard thing. I almost said twit on Twitter. Like, I had to stop myself.
Tweeter.
And remember the order to say those in. Anyway, so, you know, I get everybody can't donate. Please share it. I know we have a lot of time to do it. Like I said, last year we launched in September. We did very well with it. I just figured I'd give us some more time and hopefully raise a little bit more money. The prize that you can win are obviously, you know, basically the same as last year, but you can look at the list. Unfortunately, due to the Steeler schedule, we don't have Steeler tickets, but we do have the Total Sports gift card now, as well as, is it one of our hats or two of our shirts?
Hats.
We added a hat,
hats.
Yeah.
Yeah, hat. So that, which obviously everybody wants that. So, yeah. Give what you can give if you can give. If not, just please share it and get more eyeballs on that. We are part of the Pod Hub Network. We should always add that at the end, too.
Stay tuned to our Twitter for something to do with the early next month.
Mm. Yes, that as well. I'm going to make a flyer for something, and then we will be announcing that. So head on over to podhubnetwork.com. You can check us out. You can check out all the other shows on there. Follow us on Twitter, Instagram. We do have a Facebook now. You can go like us on there.
Yeah.
And
we're almost at 100 Twitch followers.
Follow us on Twitch. We're like one away now after this.
One away?
So, yeah. So follow us on Twitch. If you're feeling generous and you got an Amazon Prime, you can link it to your Twitch. Twitch Prime. Free sub every month. It does not renew. You can drop it right here. And we will talk to you guys in a couple days.
Yeah.
Couple days.
Great.